We say thank you to Southend Citadel Gospel Choir for bringing us that lovely song to start our worship today. Jesus will still be there. And that's a lovely thought to get our time of worship off together. We're going to commence with our opening song, In the Army of Jesus, We've Taken Our Stand. It's song 960, if you're using and following along in your songbook. And of course, it has the chorus, I'll Stand for Christ. For Christ alone. Let's enjoy this together.
Breaking news tonight, rage across America. Protesters out today over the killing of George Floyd. After a night of nationwide violence, parts of Atlanta crashed, Minneapolis set on fire. Clashes with police in cities big and small, businesses destroyed. The protesters outside the White House.
See you. Help us to help each other, Lord, each other's cross to bear. Let each his friendly aid afford and feel his brother's care. Father God, at this time we think of the unrest in America and other parts of the world where injustice happens. Lord, we never understand it, but as Christian people we are called to love each other. And that is the prayer we ask this morning, that you will intervene in these situations and brother will stop fighting brother, hatred will be no more, that we will live in peace and walk in the path that you sent your son to walk, and that is to love each other. So Lord, at this difficult time we pray for all people everywhere, no matter what colour they are all your people, whether yellow, black or white, they are all precious in your sight. And Lord, as we think of the weeks that have gone by during this coronavirus, Lord, we've had time to reflect and we've had time to think on what you want for each one of our lives. May we never put off what you want us to do, Lord, because we do it with willing hearts. Lord, I come and ask you this morning to be with those who have had to isolate, with those who have had heavy burdens at this time. And Lord, we know that if they look to you, you will see them through to the next stage. And Lord, I pray in the next few weeks, the few months, the way forward will be different for many of us. Church may be done in a different way. But Lord, whatever happens, it's in your name that we do it. And Lord, as we think of our families and friends, wherever they are at this time, draw close to them. Draw close to them in a way that they know that we are thinking about them and praying about them. And Lord, we just want to say thank you for all that you mean to each one of us. Although our church family are separated at this time, we know that through prayer, through multimedia, and through the spoken word on the phone or text, or whichever way we communicate at the moment, we know that we are praying for our church family. Lord, bless them. Keep them safe. And for those who need an extra prayer at this time, draw close to them. One day we will be united again. As I've said, maybe not in the same way, Lord, but in a way that we will reach out to those who are searching, those who are asking, those who have tuned in to see what this God thing is all about. But Lord, we rejoice that we have a risen Saviour who loves each one of us and will continue to love us. But in return, we have to love him who first gave his love for us. So Lord, as we look forward with anticipation and also with some feeling of fantastic hope that is out there, a good opportunity to move forward and spread your word. So Lord, be with us this morning. Keep us safe and keep us in your arms of love. This we ask in the worthy and most precious name of the one who died and rose for each one of us, Jesus Christ our Saviour. Amen.
I wonder how many films you've watched while you've had this enforced period of staying at home. Possibly, like us, you've watched one or two new films and possibly one or two films that are your favourites. One of my favourite films is the film Volcano, which is all about where the city of Los Angeles discovered that it was actually being built on a volcano. And of course, it erupts and causes quite severe devastation in the city. And it's how the city comes together. Ordinary men and women going about their ordinary business, but they come together they put aside all their differences and they really try to overcome this disaster that they're facing. But the clip I like most is the one at the very end. Just have a watch and see for yourself.
Dad! Let's go find your mom. What's she look like?
She looks like... Look at their faces. They all look the same.
That's good, isn't it? But it's a film that reminds me of God's love for us, especially through times like this, because he loves each one of us. Like all good films, it's got its heroes, it's got its villains who then become heroes. It's got lots of exciting bits and lots of bits which are perhaps harder to understand and challenge us. But throughout it all, it reminds us that we are not alone, that there are other people around us, and that we're all equal in God's eyes because he loves each one of us. And when we face challenging times, as those people did in that depicted in that film, and as we have done in recent weeks, we can all stand together. And if we work together, we're stronger than working on our own. Of course, God is there with us too. Even amidst the confusion, or even though sometimes we can't always understand exactly where he is in everything, somewhere amidst the confusion, God is there.
Thank you. 10, verses 34 and 35. Peter began to speak. I now realize that it is true that God treats everyone on the same basis. Those who worship him and do what is right are acceptable to him, no matter what the race may belong to. Amen.
His last few weeks have been marred by the sickening death of George Floyd whilst he was being detained by the Minneapolis police in the USA. His death is shocking to all of us who believe in a just, lawful and equal society. And we all know it sparked protests around the world. All of us sense the desperation, the frustration, the fear and anger, and the outrage that has driven people to do these things that perhaps they would not even think about doing under normal circumstances. Although we disagree with the riots, the destruction of property, the thuggery and the looting that has taken place, and we question why these disagreements couldn't be addressed through dialogue rather than through violence, our hearts still cry out against the offences of prejudice, discrimination, segregation, and racism. Violence isn't the answer. But we have to ask the question, why did it come to this? Prejudice judges a man's character by his outward appearance. Discrimination deprives a person of the right to have. Segregation deprives a person of the right to belong. Stereotyping deprives a person of the right to be. Racism deprives a person of the right to birth. We need to cry out against these things, and none of us can stay silent. While we were living in South Africa, our youngest daughter started school and obviously quickly started making friends. Just out of curiosity, I asked her if her best friend was a little black girl or a white girl. To which she replied, "I don't know. I'll have a look tomorrow." She was her friend, and it really didn't matter what colour she was. I was taught a very important lesson by a five-year-old, and it's a lesson which I will never forget. It didn't matter what her colour was, she was still her friend. It seems ironic that the worst differences between races are exaggerated when brown and pink people are labelled black and white. Those very terms themselves begin to polarise our thinking between two extremes, rather than emphasising the closeness of the two. They emphasise the differences in people rather than the similarities. Stereotypes lead to prejudice. Stereotyping is a lazy way of lumping people together, all of those from a certain class, or a certain occupation, or a certain race, and attributing to each individual the same characteristics for the group. Although something may generally be true of a group, it's not specifically true of each person in that group. We only have to look at our own families to know that each of us, even though we belong to the same family, we all have different characteristics and we are not all the same. Such stereotypes as blondes are all dizzy or dumb, teenagers are all rebellious, all preachers are lazy, all men are pigs, and all women are temperamental, do not demonstrate our careful, calculated observations and are often insulting and rude, and they show our laziness of judgment and our blind acceptance of some generalisation as being the rule. The Bible says that those who judge according to outward appearance are foolish, that we do not see people the way that God sees them. 1 Samuel 16 verse 7 says, For the Lord does not see a man as a man sees. For man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Perhaps it's time all of us take a longer, harder look at ourselves before we try judging others and labelling them. Prejudice is ugly. It divides, isolates, and ostracizes people. Prejudice is the mark of an arrogant mind that perceives itself to be enlightened. Prejudice thinks it understands persons or actions before acquiring any actual first-hand knowledge, or before consulting with all the facts. Prejudice has its root in ignorance and leads to further ignorance. Prejudice is often blind. After Jesus healed the man who was born blind and witnessed that man's faith, he pointedly identified the Pharisees' prejudice. And John chapter 9, verses 39 to 41 says this. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are you blind too?" Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." Prejudice is a perception problem. It is defined as unfavourable judgment due to partiality. Likewise, prejudice is never neutral. It reacts strongly either for or against someone or something without knowing all the facts. Sometimes it's confused with conviction, but there is nothing that's known about being prejudiced. And then we have racial prejudice. Racism is not new. It was even a problem in biblical times. Racism causes crude descriptions of people to be used. They are often offensive and demeaning, and often are attempts of some people to elevate themselves by putting down and stepping on others. Such ugly slurs should never cross our lips. One race cannot be better than another, because all of us have sprung from the same ancestors. We are all of one blood. Acts 17, verse 26 says, "From one man he made all the nations, that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands." God must consider racism an important sin to overcome. Because he performed a notable miracle to dispel the Jewish prejudice against the Gentiles. Peter's first hint came with his vision of the animals descending from heaven upon a great sheet. The conclusion of all of those events in Acts chapter 10, verses 1 to 23, was unmistakable. He said to them, "You are well aware that it is against our law for a Jew to associate with or visit a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone impure or unclean." Then Peter began to speak. "I now realize realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. Violence isn't the answer. Violence is never the answer. There has to be a better way. But it takes both sides to be determined to resolve the issue. Those who have the power to do so should listen and get to know each other, because it's the right thing to do. And they will be surprised to see that the things which unite far outweigh the prejudices and differences that we use to divide. Silence should never be an option. Prejudice will blind us to the truth at best and cause us to believe a lie at worst. 1 Timothy 5 verse 21 says, I charge you in the sight of God and Christ Jesus and the elect angels to keep these instructions without partiality and to do nothing out of favouritism. Let's be clear. Race makes no difference to God. He shows no favouritism to any race that assumes it's superior to another. Likewise, he shows no partiality to a race that has been mistreated. Acts chapter 10, verses 28 to 35 says, I now realise how true it is that God does not show favouritism, but accepts men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. I like to think of God as being colourblind. Galatians 3 verse 28 says, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. My question to you this morning is this: are you colourblind too? Jesus commands us to love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, who created all people in your image, we are shocked at the recent events we've seen and heard. Yet it highlights what perhaps we already know and have remained silent about. Lord, forgive us. Open our blind eyes to see and give us courage to speak out for those who suffer injustice. Walk with those who face discrimination today. Protect them from harm and be their hope. Deal with those who fan the fires of discrimination. Open their eyes to the beauty and diversity of your creation and to respect the human dignity of all people. Help us to educate our minds and open our hearts to stand with those who face hatred and injustice because of their background and ethnicity, and strengthen all those who work for equal protection of the law and equal opportunities for all people. Amen.
Our closing song is number 940 in the songbook, We're an Army Fighting for a Glorious King, and it's going to be accompanied by this National Staff Band. Thank you, Lord, that in a world filled with hatred, we worship a God of love. In a world overrun by violence, we believe in a God of peace. In a world consumed by despair, we embrace a God of hope. Thank you, Lord, that in a world afraid of scarcity, we follow a God of abundance. In a world full of abuse, we trust in a God of justice. Thank you, Lord, for your presence in us and around us, for all you are and will always be, for all you call us to be. Thank you, Lord, for you. Amen.
Touched by God's grace.